What a beautiful Sabbath morning our Lord and Savior has provided for us. We've gathered here this day to remember the most important person that has ever walked the face of this earth. We're doing that individually. Each one of you knows exactly what heaven is. You know that. But if you try to describe it to the person next to you, it may be a little different. But we all know heaven exists. We all know that God resides in heaven. And on his right hand is his Son, Jesus, our Christ and Savior. We know that. That is a destination for each one of us individually. But we gather together as a group because we have a desire and a love in our heart that others will know and understand that and be drawn unto that same self heaven that we all desire. It's my prayer that each one of us we'll choose that as our destination. Bear this in mind, you've heard it before. We're not human beings having a spiritual experience. We are spiritual beings having an earthly experience. Think about that. We're here on a proving ground. Each one of us. Our lives here aren't that long. I'm one of the older ones in here anymore. But yet, let me tell you, my life has gone like that. It has gone so quickly. But yet, we're only here for a short while when you compare us to eternity. And that, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, is our destination, to be with our Lord in heaven. For those of you worshiping at home, I'm going to give you the hymn numbers and the name so you'll know it, so you can worship with us as well. The first hymn we're going to sing is hymn 63 out of the Gray Hymnal, Holy, Holy, Holy. The second hymn will be 268, that's For Bread Before Is Broken. And the closing hymn at the end of the service will be hymn 350, I'm Pressing On the Upward Way. I'm only standing in front of you this morning because our pastor has asked me to do so, because he felt the impress of the Spirit to bring the message this day. It's my prayer that each one of you would remember Ken, remember too these other gentlemen that are up here, but remember Ken especially as he brings us the message. May we each hear with an open heart, that we can understand what is being will be shared. And I'm going to read from the third book of Nephi, very familiar scripture. And again, the reason that we stand and or will shortly kneel before this altar. And this shall ye always observe to do, even as I have done, even as I have broken bread and blessed it, and gave it unto you. These are words from Christ to the Nephite. And this shall you do in remembrance of my body, which I have shown unto you. It shall be a testament unto the Father that you do always remember me. And if you do always remember me, you shall have my spirit to be with you. And it came to pass that when he had said these words, he commanded his disciples that they should take the wine of the cup and drink of it, and that they should give unto the multitude that they might drink of it. And it came to pass that they did so, and did drink of it, and were filled. And they gave unto the multitude, and they did drink, and they were filled. And when the disciples had done this, Jesus said unto them, Blessed are ye for this thing which ye have done, for this is the fulfilling of my commandments. And this doth witness unto the Father that ye are willing to do that which I have commanded you. And this shall ye always do unto those who repent and are baptized in my name, and ye shall do it in remembrance of my blood, which I have shed for you, that ye may witness unto the Father that ye do always remember me. And if you do always remember me, ye shall have my Spirit to be with you. May the Lord continue to bless us this hour, is my prayer.
Come to you this time, and Lord, we give you thanks. We give you thanks that we have this opportunity to come this day and to lift your name on high. Lord, I would ask that you would be with us this day. Lord, that we would be reminded of that sacrifice you made. Lord, that we would feel your Spirit while we bend our knees to thy table to partake of that sacrifice. That sacrifice you made for me and everyone that is here this day and everyone who lives on this great place. Lord, I'd ask that you continue to be with Ken while he brings that message that you've put into his heart for this, your flock to hear. Lord, I would ask for a prayer for those who couldn't make it. Lord, that spirit we feel this day, may they also feel that spirit. Lord, that we may feel that spirit as one, united together, one in you, Lord. Lord, we just give you thanks, and I pray all these things in the most precious name, even Jesus Christ. Amen.
An offering is something that we each can and often do participate in. Sometimes we don't even get to put money in the plate anymore because we do it online. But yet, in passing the plate, it makes us think that indeed there are temporal things here upon this earth and even in this building that need to be handled and taken care of. And let me extend a congratulations to each one of you who have participated in giving. You caused the doors to stay open, the lights to stay on, the water to flow, and we're appreciative of that. Just as a note on your bulletin, Josh will be doing the prayer over the wine this day. And I'm going to read from section 101. For as it is expedient that I, the Lord, should make every man accountable as stewards over earthly blessings, which I have made and prepared for my creatures. I, the Lord, stretched out the heavens and buildeth the earth as a very handy work, and all things therein are mine, and it is my purpose to provide for my saints, for all things are mine, but it must needs be done in mine own way. And behold, this is the way that I, the Lord, have decreed to provide for my saints, that the poor shall be exalted, in the rich are made low, for the earth is full, and there is enough and to spare. Yea, I prepare all things, and have given unto the children of men to be agents unto themselves. We do indeed have all that we need and have been blessed by our Lord. Would you bow with me? Our Father who art in heaven, it is a wonderful time that we each can share in those gifts and blessings that you have poured, out upon each one of us. Lord, you don't call for us to give a great deal. We're only called to give a tenth of that that is over and above our wants and needs. Lord, that's a very small amount in our lives. But I pray and would ask that each one that does give, that they're blessed by you. And I know they will be, Lord. We pray, too, that the monies that are collected are handled in a manner that is pleasing unto you. And once again, please bless all who give, and especially bless those who have a desire to give but cannot. And I pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you.
bow with me facing the altar for the blessing of the bread? O God, the eternal Father, we ask in the name of thy Son, Jesus Christ, to bless and sanctify this bread to the soul of all those who partake of it, that he may be eaten in remembrance of the body of thy Son, a witness unto thee, O God, the eternal Father, that they are willing to take upon them the name of thy Son, and always remember him and keep his commandments, which he has given them, that they may always have his Spirit to be with them.
Amen.
prayer is said about the wine, may we please kneel as much as possible facing the altar. O God, the eternal Father, we ask thee in the name of thy Son, Jesus Christ, to bless and sanctify this wine to the souls of all those who drink of it, that they may do in the remembrance of the blood of thy Son, which was shed for them, that they may witness unto thee, O God, the eternal Father, that they do always remember him, that they may have his spirit to be with him. Amen.
I appreciated the scripture that Rex read to us from 3rd Nephi, because it speaks to what I felt led to share this morning. And it is that added testimony of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and his willingness to come and do the will of the Father, to come and give all the honor and glory to his Heavenly Father. And as we read in Matthew chapter 26, we read very similar words as is recorded in 3rd Nephi. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and broke it and blessed it and gave to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is in remembrance of my body, which I give a ransom for you." And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of it. For this is in remembrance of my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for as many as shall believe on me, on my name, for the remission of their sins. And I give unto you a commandment, that ye shall observe to do the things which ye have seen me do, and bear record of me even unto the end." And I wanted to bring to our remembrance the importance of that which we do this day, and that we do not take lightly, that we do not forget the great sacrifice that our Heavenly Father gave for you and I, and that is the life of his Son, Jesus Christ. And as it says in Matthew here, he gave his life as a ransom, a ransom. It was that redemptive price. He paid the atonement. He was the person that took action to correct our wrongdoings, to correct the sins which we have within our life. And so it's important for us to understand that which we've shared in this day is something that is most holy, that is most sacred, and I hope we never draw weary of coming to his table, because it is imperative to our hopes, to our dreams, to the accomplishment of entering into his kingdom. Remember him always, and let that atonement that he gave be within us continually. In Matthew chapter 20, it says, "The Son of Man came to give his life a ransom." That is why he came. He came and he lived his life and he died upon the cross, and he shed his blood for the remission of our sins, my sins, your sins, for the sins of all mankind. And it says in Isaiah, "By his stripes we are healed." And we want to try to heal ourselves and think we can do it all, but we can't. We can't do it without him, without the stripes that he bore, that the blood that he shed. In 1 Timothy, Paul writes to Timothy, and he says, "For there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all." There is one God and one mediator, and we need to understand that that mediator is Jesus Christ. He is the one that came. He is the one that washes us clean. He is the one that makes us whole. In Doctrine and Covenants section 16, it says, "The Lord your Redeemer suffered death in the flesh, that all men might repent and come unto him." He suffered death in the flesh, that all men might repent. And we hear that word over and over again, the word repent. And again, I hope we never draw weary of hearing that, because we in this earthly world are men of the flesh, and we seek things of this world, and we fail and we fall. But through repentance, we are brought back to our Lord through Jesus Christ. And so it is, he says, to come unto him. Last Sunday, we heard our brother Vic share in those words of the importance to come unto him. And here he's telling us again to repent and come unto him. "Come unto me, all ye labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Come, be partakers of my kingdom. Come, find joy in me. Come, be comforted. Come, allow me to be a part of who you are. Come. And yet, we struggle. We struggle. And find it difficult at times to come. But he calls us to continually come and to be a part of the body of Christ, to come and participate and share in the beauty of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In section 28, he says, listen to the voice of Jesus Christ, your Redeemer, the great I Am, whose arm of mercy hath atoned for your sins, whose arm of mercy has atoned for your sins. Who will gather his people even as a hen gathereth her chickens under her wings, even as many as will hearken to my voice and humble themselves before me and call upon me in mighty prayer. Come. He has atoned for our sins when we turn to him in repentance, and he desires to gather us together in the outstretched arms that he has for us, that we might find protection and peace and comfort and joy. Come, come, let he who atoned for our sins wash us clean. In the letter to the Ephesians, Paul writes, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. We are redeemed through his blood and forgiveness of our sins, according to his grace. We cannot do it ourselves. It's only through his grace as we humble ourselves before him. In Proverbs chapter 23, he says, for their Redeemer is mighty. He shall plead their cause with thee. The Redeemer is the one who buys us back. And who is that? That is our Savior Jesus Christ. He came and paid the price that we might be bought back, that we might once again enter into his kingdom. The Redeemer is mighty, and he pleads our cause with thee. In this past week, I was down in our family room looking through some books. Mark gives me books about every week, and so I was going through some books that I had, and I was looking at them, and I saw up on the top of the bookcase downstairs in the family room that we have, there's a guitar that sits up on this bookcase and is up there to keep from getting played with, I guess, and torn up. And I've had this guitar for over 50 years now within the family. And I was reminded of how I obtained that guitar. You see, I'm old enough to remember, maybe some of you are too, to remember the old S&H green stamps? I hear you back. You're old too, huh? Yeah. The S&H green stamps. It was a rewards program years ago that was started in about like 1890, something like that, and went to the around 1980, early 1980s, and then it faded away. But it was a trading stamp type program where when you went to a store and you purchased things, when you checked out of the store, the clerk or the teller, based on how much you spent, would then reach over and dial a little thing, and out would come these S&H green stamps. And you would take those stamps and you would put them in a little folder, a little smaller than the Book of Mormon here, and had several pages, and you collected those. And when you got so many of them saved up, you could go and you could redeem those. You could redeem them for items and purchase things. And I remember that my mom and dad had these, and they told us that, they told me that I could go and we could buy something. My mom probably remembers this. And we went to the S&H green stamp store. And if I remember correctly, it was over on 23rd Street, just west of Chrysler. There used to be a Thriftway store and a Crown Drug and a a dime store or something, and there was this store, S&H Green Stamp Store. And we went in there, and I saw the guitar, and we purchased the guitar with those S&H Green Stamps. And I still have that guitar today. My mom gave it to me a few years ago and told me that to keep it. And I got to thinking about that, how it is with our life. We were able to redeem those stamps and purchase something. And when the book was full, you took it in. But you know, our Heavenly Father is calling us as the Redeemer to give those things to Him, whatever they are. Take that book of life and fill it up. Fill it up with those things that hold us back, those things that beset us, those things that we call sins, those omissions of things that we've done, that we might take that and give it to Him and say, Lord, here I am. This is all I am. Take it. Redeem it. Redeem it for my salvation. I seek to purchase the kingdom. That's my heart's desire. Take it. Take my life. Here, it's yours. Take it to the Father and redeem my salvation. In 1 John chapter 2, my little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. But if any man sin and repent, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And He is the propitiation of our sins. And if you have a hard time saying that word like I do, propitiation, you can use the word atonement. That's what it means. And He is the propitiation or atonement for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. We have an advocate with the Father, and that advocate is one who defends, one who would plead our cause and our case. And that advocate is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He is the advocate. Without Him, He is the way to the kingdom. He is the way to the Father. In section 28, it says, I am the advocate with the Father. It is His good will to give you the kingdom. That's why He invites us to come over and over and over again. It's because He desires to give us the kingdom. But in order to give us the kingdom, we have to turn our lives over to Him. We have to fill that book full and say, here, take it, Jesus. This is yours. I'm emptying myself of self and giving it to you. Go, be my advocate with the Father. Section 45, listen to Him who is the advocate with the Father, who is pleading your cause before Him. He is pleading your cause before the Father. Turn your life over to Him. And don't become weary of coming each Sunday and partake of the Sabbath on that first Sabbath of the month, or whenever you might decide we could do it. But remember, He redeemed His life for you and I. We cannot do it without Him, the Advocate. Have you ever, I was going to ask for a raise of hands, but I won't do that, but have you ever got a speeding ticket, some kind of violation, and you didn't want to pay the fine, or you didn't want to get the points on your license? A lot of you young guys out there, I had three sons. I know how that goes. We had an attorney that we kept pretty busy for a while. But you didn't want to pay the fine or get the points or whatever it might be, whatever it was. And so you would hire and you went and got an advocate that would go and plead for you. He would plead your cause. And it didn't matter what it might be. And you know, those things weren't life-changing. You might lose your license maybe or something if you get enough points or whatever, or get enough of those tickets. But you know, if you've never stood before a court, before a judge, with your life in balance, you'll never know what it's like. To be considering the options, which are freedom, which might be incarcerated. I'll share my experience. Most of you know my younger days, and I've shared testimony before, that I gave my parents some fits. Not proud of that. But it caused much heartache within the family. And in so much that I found myself in that situation. I found myself being arrested. Wasn't the first time, but it was the worst of times. And I was charged with a felony, being 18 years old as an adult. That was a very serious offense. And the crime that I committed was very, honestly, it could have been deadly. And I won't go into the details of what that was, but I found myself being faced with that option. For you see, the penalty of the crime either could have been found free, innocent, or you could have been found up to 5 years in prison. And you stand before a judge when those charges are read, and you hear those words, it's an awakening and a reflection of your life. And as I sat in the jail cell, my parents had already contacted an attorney, and he called down and wished to speak to me. And so they took me out of the cell and they put me in an interrogation room, which I had been in before. And he called and he said, "Listen to me. Don't say anything. I will do your speaking for you. I will share your words. Don't say a word." And so I didn't. Thankfully, I have such very loving and caring parents that they posted a very hefty bond. And I was out. But yet I still had much before me. And I remember talking with my dad. I remember the spot in the house where we were at. We were getting ready to go see my advocate. And my dad looked at me and he says, "You gotta tell him everything. You gotta tell him everything. You have to be truthful. Don't hold anything back. Be truthful. Don't hold anything back. Because if you don't, he can't help you. And so I did. I met with the advocate. And I told him everything within my life. Everything that I had done. And was completely truthful and honest. And when we stand before the judge in a courtroom, and your life is in peril, the advocate speaks for you. And the advocate pled my case before the judge. And after several weeks of him advocating on my behalf, it came to an understanding to reduce my charges, get him dropped to a misdemeanor, and to serve 2 years of probation, which I readily agreed to. And so you see, our Heavenly Father is that advocate. This isn't a game that we're involved in. This is a matter of two choices. We can choose to enter his kingdom and be in his presence, or we can choose to suffer in sorrow and anguish. But in this life, we have the opportunity to seek the advocate each and every day, to fill that book up with those stamps of those things that we've done that would hold us back. But we have to be completely honest. We have to be open. He already knows us, but we have to be honest and reveal to him. Here I am, Lord. Sorry. Make amends wherever it needs to be amended. Make things right where there's been a wrong. Seek your Heavenly Father that he knows that you were sincere. For he desires to plead your case before the Father. He desires to hear your words. You know, after I served those 2 years of probation, I went back to my advocate. And he once again went before the judge and pled for my behalf. And my record was expunged. It was completely erased and removed completely. And you know, our Heavenly Father does the same for us. He does the same for us. In section 58, behold, he who has repented of his sins, the same is forgiven. And I, the Lord, remembereth them no more. When you turn to your Heavenly Father in sincerity of heart, and you are truthful and honest with him, and you seek him, and you allow that redeeming blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, when we come and remember him and all that he is within our lives, when we come and offer our whole heart with that broken heart and contrite spirit, he is there to receive. Remember the Redeemer. Remember the Advocate. He is one and the same. And he is willing to plead your case, but you have to turn and allow him to do so. whatever it is that's within our lives, whatever it is that think that we might have done, there is nothing so great that our Heavenly Father is not willing to forgive us. He is still calling unto us to come and receive the kingdom which he has prepared for each and every one of us. Come, be a joy of peace. Be a people of love. Be a people in meekness and humility. Be a people who are willing to gather together under his outstretched arms. And in doing so, we would lift up our voice and rejoice. He is a God of love. He is a God that desires to forgive us. He is a God that continually calls. We must respond, and we must be truthful and honest and open ourselves up to him that he can truly go as our advocate and plead our cause before the Father, that we might hear those words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." And we can find ourselves on the right hand of the Heavenly Father, for that is our hope and that is our desire. And I pray as we go forward that we will each look inwardly and seek him in all that we do and continually turn to him and allow those stripes that were upon him to heal us and that we might be washed clean, that we would be a redeemed people. Might he bless us as we go forward.
Our loving Heavenly Father, we stand before you at this time united in song and prayer to lift our hearts unto you and to thank you, Father, for the great and wonderful blessings you've given us, even your Son, Jesus Christ. He died and paid the price for each and every one of us. And through his life and resurrection, Father, we have that opportunity this day to come before you, to follow you, and to have that faith, Father, that it takes, like my brother Ken has spoken, faith in our advocate, that he stands before you this day on our behalf. We ask, Father, that you may go with us, each and every one, that this may take this message to heart, and that we may apply it in our lives. And until we meet again, Father, to come to you as one, we stand united in prayer. I ask that you be with each and every one of us. I ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ.